Hi, I'm TJ Savereno with Clemson Cooperative Extension. I'm a forestry and wildlife biologist, and we're here amidst some longleaf wet savanna habitat to talk about the characteristic ground cover species that we find here. Longleaf covers a big geographic range, but it covers a diverse number of different types of subhabitats, if you will.
So I'm standing in the middle of a longleaf savanna habitat, and it's one of the more unique longleaf habitats characterized usually by a lower basal area or fewer trees in the forest. It has, among the longleaf habitats, it has some of the most diverse plant species in the ground cover and some of the most unique plant species in the ground cover. The soil is very acidic. Sometimes these areas they're usually very wet, but sometimes they're inundated for parts of the year. And so the soils are very acidic, and many of the plants that live in this habitat, in these longleaf savannas, have special adaptations to the soils that they live in. It's a place where you find many of our orchids and carnivorous plants and species like sundews and hatpins, you know, many of these unique plant species.
These wet longleaf savannas are characterized by very acidic soils. And if you know from sampling the turf in your yard before you apply fertilizer that you have to adjust the pH because those nutrients aren't available. And so there's a number of different plants that have adapted to the lack of certain nutrients that they need, such as phosphorus and nitrogen. Of course, they're able to make their own food because they are photosynthetic plants, but they need these nutrients that aren't really available in the acidic soils. And one of the adaptations made by this plant that you see in front of us, these in bloom are Venus flytraps, which are endemic species found only in parts of eastern South Carolina and eastern North Carolina. And their adaptation, as you probably know by now, if you're familiar with Venus flytraps, is that they are able to lure in and catch insects that are probing their specialized plant parts. And by digesting those insects, some of those nutrients become available. So that is just one of the mechanisms that plants have found to adapt to these low pH soils and the low availability of certain nutrients that they need. So another characteristic of longleaf pine ecosystems is that they are very fire dependent. The natural ecosystem is fire dependent. And you can see from the bark on this tree that fire has been used as a management tool in this area. And in these areas that tend to produce a lot of competing woody vegetation, those fires need to occur about every 2 to 3 years at least. To keep it under control. Now this tree that I'm leaning on is one of the other species of pine that are found in these ecosystems. And it's not a longleaf, it's a pond pine. And one of the ways you can tell that is by what we call epicormic sprouting, these little branches coming right out of the bark of the tree. Another characteristic of pond pine is that it has serotonous cones. You see this cone in front of me looks like kind of a top shape. And these cones need to be exposed to a certain degree of heat before they will open up and drop their seeds. That way it ensures that the ground has been prepared for that seed bed before those cones drop their seeds. As in other longleaf ecosystems, native grasses play a vital role in sustaining the ecosystem. That is because the dried stems of previous years' growth provide a fine, readily ignitable fuel source that help carry the fire across the ground. One of the very interesting grasses that is found only in locations with wetter soils is toothache grass. The entire plant is very aromatic, and when its parts are chewed, it numbs sensation in the mouth. Because of this characteristic, it was used historically, and is still used by some, as a natural remedy to ease toothache pain, hence the common name. Like many other plants in longleaf ecosystems, toothache grass generally only flowers following a fire.
Hi, I'm Sudie Thomas. I work with the Natural Resources Conservation Service, and we've been showing y'all different longleaf habitats and the important elements that they provide to wildlife. We've been mainly focusing on the ground cover and all the species, the grasses and wildflowers and endemic, unique carnivorous plants that you find in these habitats. And there are programs that landowners can enroll in with the Farm Bill that can help them with the management that will maintain healthy longleaf habitats and restore longleaf savannas like the one we've seen today. Some of the practices that landowners can employ and maybe get financial assistance for are thinning their pine stands, planting longleaf, prescribed fire and fire breaks, and then also wetland restoration, which is really important in longleaf pine savannas where there might be drainage ditches.
We hope that you've enjoyed this video and have found it beneficial. We also hope that it will inspire you to get out in the longleaf woodlands and find some of these species for yourself. Again, programs are available to assist landowners with fire breaks, burning, mid-story hardwood control, planting, and many other practices. Check with your local state forestry agency or the USDA Natural Resources Conservation Service office to see what resources may be available to you.